When we think of scuba diving, we usually imagine a diver with a scuba cylinder on their back and an open circuit regulator going into their mouth, exhausting bubbles as they exhale. But there is, of course, also the image of the diver with the black hose looping around their head. This is called a rebreather. But what exactly is rebreather diving? Rebreathers are an advanced type of diving that allow divers to recycle the gas they use, thus extending their bottom time and reducing the bubbles they produce. While rebreathers originally were very experimental, they have also slowly found their way into technical and even recreational diving. Unlike traditional scuba cylinders, rebreathers recycle the gas, replenish the oxygen content, and enable the divers to dive longer with less decompression times and much, much more bottom time. But how exactly does this technology work? Let's find out. This program is self-funded, but if you want to support scuba science, you can absolutely do that by subscribing to the Dive Saga channel, leaving a comment, liking the video, and checking out some of our merch. Maybe you even want to pick one up for yourself. That goes a long way into funding this series. At its core, a rebreather functions by capturing the diver's exhaled gas, scrubbing it of carbon dioxide, injecting additional oxygen to reset the required gas mix, and circulating it back to the diver for inhalation. This process drastically reduces the amount of gas that a diver uses on a given dive. So let's do a step-by-step breakdown of how the general concept of rebreather diving works. The most notable part is, of course, the loop of the rebreather. When a diver exhales, the gas does not vent out into the water, but rather into this loop and goes back into the rebreather. This means that a rebreather diver, unlike a traditional open circuit scuba diver, does not produce any bubbles. The second step is when this exhaled gas gets to the back into the unit, carbon dioxide is removed. A chemical absorbent in the scrubber unit removes carbon dioxide, avoiding the gas to become toxic for the diver. After the carbon dioxide has been removed, the gas gets analyzed by the rebreather unit. Of course, the diver has consumed some of the oxygen in the gas. As the oxygen is consumed by the diver, it must be replenished. So after the carbon dioxide has been scrubbed out of the exhaled breathing gas, new, fresh oxygen must be injected. Sensors continuously monitor the oxygen levels in the loop. When the oxygen levels drop below a certain amount, fresh oxygen is injected into the breathing gas. Some rebreathers, particularly those for deeper technical diving, are capable of producing different gas mixes. So they will mix oxygen with a diluent gas, for instance helium, to create the ideal mix for the specific depth the diver is at. After CO2 has been removed, oxygen and diluent has been added to create the desired mix, this gas is then put back into the loop and presented to the diver for inhalation. As this cycle repeats itself continuously, it greatly reduces the amount of gas the diver needs to bring on the dive. Rebreathers come in different types for different diving needs. For instance, oxygen rebreathers, also referred to as pure O2 rebreathers, are often used by the military and really only work for very shallow, long diving. They provide 100% oxygen to the diver, but as discussed in our video about the dangers of scuba diving, breathing pure oxygen is only safe at very shallow depths. But these units are very silent and are great for stealthy operations since they produce no bubbles and allow a very long dive time. Semi-closed rebreathers, or SCRs, will mix oxygen with another gas, usually air or nitrox, in a fixed ratio. They will dump a little bit of gas into the surrounding water to get rid of carbon dioxide. They are more efficient than traditional open-circuit scuba diving, but still produce a little bit of waste, as opposed to closed-circuit rebreathers. Closed-circuit rebreathers, or CCRs, are the most advanced types of rebreather units. They fully recycle the breathing gas, as mentioned earlier, by scrubbing the carbon dioxide and injecting new gas to keep levels constant. Because they are able to produce gas based on the diver's needs, they are commonly used in deeper technical diving. But CCRs also require rigorous training, because there is a significant risk in using a CCR that malfunctions. The prime advantage of using a rebreather is, of course, to increase the bottom time. Because gas use is so highly optimized, divers can stay underwater significantly longer than if they were bringing a comparable volume of gas on open circuit. While an open circuit diver might deplete a scuba cylinder in 30 to 60 minutes, depending on the depth and the size of the cylinder, a similar dive performed on a CCR could last several hours. There is also the added advantage of bubble-free diving. Because the gas is recycled and nothing is dumped into the water in terms of exhaled gas, that actually means that the unit is very quiet. Many types of marine life are often frightened of scuba divers exactly because of this exhaled gas into the water. So having a CCR typically allows you to get much, much closer to marine life. This makes them a preferred way of diving for instance, underwater photographers and videographers. There is also simply the improved gas efficiency. When we breathe from a scuba cylinder and exhale, we have never consumed all the oxygen that was available in the gas. So by recycling this gas, we are absolutely optimizing every bit of the breathing gas. Especially when it comes to deeper diving involving trimix, which is a helium-based gas, as you can learn about in our Gases of Scuba Diving video, helium is very expensive, and being able to recycle this gas over and over reduces the cost significantly. Because, as mentioned earlier, CCRs can present the diver with the ideal gas for the depth they are at, this will greatly reduce nitrogen or gas narcosis, and it will extend bottom times. And lastly, this all results in less decompression obligation, because once again, the diver is breathing the most ideal gas for that depth, giving them the longest no-stop limit possible. But rebreathers have their own set of specific and considerable risks, so it is very important to seek proper training, and most manufacturers will not sell you a rebreather unit if you cannot present a certification for that unit. One of the main dangers is the risk of hypoxia or hyperoxia. As we've discussed in our video about the dangers of scuba diving, hypoxia means a shortage of oxygen in the breathing gas, which will of course result in the diver becoming unconscious because their oxygen needs are not being met. On the other hand, hyperoxia means too much oxygen in the breathing gas, which can lead to central nervous system oxygen toxicity, resulting in a convulsion which is deadly underwater because the diver could drown. Of course, the units will regulate the oxygen content in the breathing gas, but technology can always fail. So monitoring these oxygen levels is one of the many things divers learn in CCR training. Because the rebreather relies on the scrubber to remove carbon dioxide from the breathing gas, it is of course possible that there is a failure in this component of the CCR. Buildup of carbon dioxide levels could once again lead to a breathing gas that is unsafe for the diver to breathe, causing the diver to pass out from hypercapnia or increased CO2 levels. Because rebreathers are more complex pieces of equipment than traditional open-circuit scuba diving equipment, they have a much more rigorous pre- and post-diving checklist and much more comprehensive maintenance. So obviously, failing to do these checks or this maintenance can much more easily lead to terrible accidents. Moreover, scrubber material needs to be replenished frequently and oxygen sensors need to be checked and calibrated and potentially replaced. Another drawback of rebreather diving is the relatively high startup cost. Where an average set of open circuit scuba diving equipment can cost as little as $1,000 to $1,500, a rebreather unit very quickly sets you back $8,000 or more, and that is without the proper training. Moreover, the regular maintenance, which is more complex than with open circuit scuba, will also carry an increased cost. Divers who are doing deeper dives can offset this cost by saving on expensive breathing gases such as helium. And lastly, more extensive training is required. Where the equipment on open circuit scuba is relatively simple to use and to learn how to use, rebreathers do require more time and more practice. Emergency procedures, for instance, system failures, also require much more training and, once again, repeated practice throughout the diver's career. Due to the complexity of rebreathers, divers must follow specific protocol to keep themselves safe. For instance, pre-dive safety checks, ensuring the oxygen sensors, gas levels, and scrubber are all functional before the dive. Divers must also construct a bailout plan. Because rebreathers are more complex and can fail during a dive, divers must calculate and bring gases that will enable them to get out of any situation on open circuit that they plan to be in. Moreover, rebreathers require constant monitoring. It is extremely unsafe to just rely on the computer of the unit to guide you through the dive. The diver must think their way through the dive and regularly check oxygen partial pressure levels to make sure that they stay safe. Moreover, proper maintenance is absolutely key. Divers must regularly clean their unit and replenish the scrubber material to make sure that the unit can operate safely. And because most rebreathers have complex electronics on board, it is also important to have backups of these electronics to check them regularly and to make sure that they are functional. All of this probably leads you to understand that rebreathers are not for everyone. Open circuit scuba provides access to many dive sites, and for many divers, open circuit scuba is just perfect. But, for instance, technical divers who want to explore dive sites at a greater depth for a greater amount of time will struggle to bring the gases required to do this on open circuit. So having the gas used in a more efficient way with more optimized partial pressures of oxygen is the preferred way. Moreover, on extremely deep dives where helium is involved, this can also mean a significant cost reduction. Underwater photographers and videographers will often prefer rebreathers, once again because of the absence of bubbles on the exhale, not scaring away underwater life. Military and commercial divers might benefit from the extended dive time and the reduced decompression obligations. And even recreational divers may, of course, venture into rebreather diving because they want the challenge of the training and the comfort that rebreather diving offers. Rebreathers are definitely a revolutionary tool that is coming of age as we speak. Improved gas efficiency, bubble-free diving, and the reduction of cost in certain settings, as well as the reduction in decompression times, make it a very attractive choice for a specific type of divers. But it is important to be aware of the extensive training and the extensive initial setup cost that it will require. Moreover, it is extremely dangerous to attempt diving on a rebreather unit that you are not certified to use. You must absolutely seek training for the specific unit that you want to dive. But by understanding how rebreathers work and by training rigorously for the appropriate safety protocols, divers can use this instrument to unlock dive times and depths that were previously unavailable to them. Rebreathers have come a long way since their initial conception, and it is very exciting to see where they will go next as a result of scuba science.